And an even greater admission from the vice president in that interview with ABC. He also seems to have confessed to a war crime. Mr. Cheney not only defending the tactics used against terror suspect Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, including waterboarding, but also coming close to admitting he authorized them.
Did you authorize the tactics that were used against Khalid Sheikh Mohammed?
I was aware of the program, certainly, and involved in helping get the process cleared. That is, the agency, in effect, came in and wanted to know what they could and couldn't do. And they talked to me as well as others to explain what they wanted to do, and I supported it.
Of course, Cheney insists what was done to Khalid Sheikh Mohammed was not torture, and of course, that's not actually the order in which events transpired. As the Senate's new bipartisan report on the abuse of detainees in U.S. custody at Guantanamo Bay, Abu Ghraib, and elsewhere makes clear, first the president and vice president signed off on the torture of detainees, then the CIA came looking for legal cover on the torture it had already been ordered to commit. Let's turn now to Jonathan Turley, constitutional law professor with George Washington University. John, thanks for your time tonight.
Hi, Keith.
So as overly dramatic as this question will sound, did Dick Cheney just confess to a war crime?
Yeah, it's an interesting question, isn't it? It's like that type of Zen question. If someone commits a crime and everyone's around to see it and does nothing, is it still a crime? And I think that's really the argument of this administration. It can't be a crime because no one's prosecuted us for it. But it most certainly is a crime to participate, to create, to, in many ways, monitor a torture program. And indeed, it's one of the crimes that defines a nation committed to the rule of law. If you have to create a new nation, one of the first things you do is to disavow this form of illegality. So you have the vice president sitting there saying, yeah, we talked about it. They came to me. I supported it, and I helped put it through. The only problem is what he is describing is most certainly and unambiguously a war crime.
Except if, as you suggest, nobody prosecutes him for that, which it jumps ahead to the lasting legacy of what happens if the next administration does not press this. Do we let, you know, the International Court at The Hague come in and take over all of our responsibilities for policing our own act here? Or where does this go domestically if he's made such a statement?
Frankly, Keith, that's what worries me the most, is that you can't talk about change without having some moral component to it. It's not just about creating jobs or lowering the price of gasoline. What occurred in the last 8 years was an assault on who we are. And I think that President-elect Obama is going to have to decide whether he wants power without principle or whether he wants to start with a true change, to say that no matter where an investigation will take us, if there are crimes to be found, they will be prosecuted. Now, right now, many leaders in Congress are trying to create a new commission that is designed to avoid any criminal prosecution, and those leaders happen to be Democratic leaders. But it will ultimately depend on citizens and whether they will remain silent in the face of a crime that's been committed in plain view.
A little less obvious, perhaps, because there's no confession up front, but what was in that Senate report, that the person who authorized all the abuse of, and torture of the prisoners at Abu Ghraib in Iraq was President Bush. Could that be a war crime?
Well, it most certainly can. That's the amazing thing about all of this, is that the fact that this is a war crime is pretty much accepted by most legal experts. In fact, it's hard to find one who says that it's not. Waterboarding goes back to the Spanish Inquisition. It wasn't some invention of Dick Cheney's mind. It was something we prosecuted Japanese officers for when they did it against our soldiers. The English sends people to death for it. We prosecuted people again even earlier than World War II in the Philippines. It is a well-established war crime. It's not the law that's in question here. The question is the politics, and most importantly, whether the citizens of this country will understand that they can't simply treat Cheney like some Darth Vader who controls their very thoughts and actions. It is equally immoral to stand silent in the face of a war crime and do nothing. And that is what the citizens are doing. There's this gigantic yawn as we hear about a war crime on national television being discussed matter-of-factly by the vice president. And by the way, Keith, there was a hearing not that long ago, which was equally shocking, with an administration official sort of casually comparing different types of waterboarding, like the stuff that Pol Pot used as opposed to the Spanish Inquisition. And I stood there in disbelief that in Congress we were having this rather pleasant conversation about American-style waterboarding.
But is that what you're referring to in there, the collective yawn, is that the legal principle on which Dick Cheney is resting his case that waterboarding is not torture, therefore it is not illegal, therefore it would not be a war crime?
Well, in my view, there is no plausible legal theory because there is existing legal precedent establishing that this is a war crime. That's why Attorney General Casey refused to answer the question, because he could not answer the question at his confirmation, is waterboarding a crime, a war crime, because he knew that the case has established that it is. And if he answered that question, there would be serious repercussions.
All right, $100 to any senator who asks Eric Holder that question next month. Constitutional law professor Jonathan Turley, as always, John, great thanks.
Thanks, Keith.